Okay. Hey, this is Professor Immler. I had said in class today that we weren't able to get through Descartes. We really want to make sure we get through Descartes because that will set up what we do next time, which will be Locke. So this is the rest of the lecture on Descartes and rationalism. So what we have here and what I'll be talking through is screenshots and board notes from another class where we're able to get through all of it. So I'll just talk us through this. Now, we had started about with his journey into certainty, right? And we had said how in class that there were all of these problems that Descartes had encountered. He wanted that certainty that he found in mathematics, but when he went and looked at what was considered truth and knowledge of his day, he found all sorts of problems. So he employed that radical doubt. We don't ever want to forget this when it comes to Descartes. Radical doubt. That's his method. And remember, it's not about whether or not something is proved false, but whether we can have doubt about it. That's what you gotta know. So at the very beginning of his project, he says, okay, I'm gonna doubt anything I can possibly doubt. So that immediately, when he looks at things, is history, religious authorities, etc. Then, and we said that this is going to be a descent, and then hopefully we'll see what we are able to build. So the next thing is the senses. Can we trust our senses? And he says no, and we looked at some of this in class. Sometimes our eyes lie to us. Sometimes we think we hear stuff, but really, nothing was there. We also realize that, well, we might be dreaming. That's a possibility. We don't know for sure if it's happening now or at any point in time, but we know we've had those dreams that have seemed so real. You wake up and you think it's happened, but after a few moments, or for me, after I talked to my wife, oh, shoot, that didn't happen. I was just dreaming that. It was the thing I was really anxious about. But come to find out, it didn't really happen. But I had imagined it while I was asleep. That seems so real that we can't, it's indistinguishable. And so Descartes says, hey, it is possible that right now you could be dreaming. And like we said in class, maybe it's a really boring dream. Maybe it's an everyday dream or a nightmare if it's really a boring situation. But it's possible that we could be dreaming. That's another argument tied in with maybe our senses are unreliable, right? And so that's something to think about. This idea of, well, let's get a little bit smaller pen. Unreliable. And if I misspell anything, sorry. That's just what you get when you're in one of my classes. So, unreliable. So, and what that means is, well, we might not, if all of our senses are doubtable, right? This unreliableness. How do we know we have a physical body? We don't, right? Like right now, I'm feeling, right, my lack of hair, all this stuff. But if I cannot trust my senses themselves, how do I know there's a physical me here? You could imagine. I'm not able to draw, but it might be the case that, we are a little, this is a vat of water, that we are a squiggly little brain in that, right? And that we're just imagining. We have these dreams of having a body. To use what I think the film's like 20 years old at this point, right? But the Matrix. Maybe it's that deep and that pure of an illusion. So let's erase this because it's kind of incomprehensible. But that might be the case. And so, we can doubt that we have bodies. And this moves us into the realm of the mind. Right? We've shut out the outside world. We've decided we can possibly doubt that we have bodies. So the thing that's left is we're in the realm of the mind. And then, right, let's look at reason. And like we said in class, we were able to get to this in class. It could be the case that an evil demon, trickster, is tricking us so much that we think we're being rational, but really that itself is a trick. So what you and I would agree on, if we were able to speak to one another, and again, maybe I'm hallucinating you, maybe you're hallucinating me, again, all of this stuff. But if we are able to talk, we would say, well, maybe there's, you can't doubt that five, right? 5 + 5 = 10. But if the evil demon is so powerful, right? And we want to borrow from Catholic theology of an omnipotent good God. Well, what if, and it's possible, that God is not good? What if God, like Loki from the Marvel films, enjoys tricking us, right? So what if that God is evil, but still powerful and still God, right? So that's at least possible. Again, Descartes, he's a good Catholic. He doesn't ultimately claim this, but he says, okay, let's consider this. What if this was the case? What might that mean? Well, it might mean that 5 + 5 isn't really 10. Maybe it's 9 or blue, whatever. But the demon is tricking us, making us think that it's 10. So let's erase this and get this out of the way. Okay, so look at what we've lost. We've lost what everyone else has said is going on. All of history, religious ideas, etc. Right? That's up here. Then we've doubted our senses. And notice, that's the only way we know anything about the outside world. It's mediated through the senses. We might be dreaming. We might not even have bodies because we might be hallucinating them. So we're down to our minds. And then we maybe reason is what we can use to figure stuff out. But maybe that evil demon is tricking us. So we have cause to doubt reason itself. This sucks. We're at a pretty low point here. So, Descartes, wrestling with these implications, doesn't like them, but has to deal with them. So he comes to this point of, I have the Latin here and the English translation here. He says, I'm doubting. And if I'm doubting, right, like what's happening when you doubt? You're thinking. And it cannot be the case that the evil demon, right, cannot trick you into the experience of, and that's important. Experience of doubting. Right? Cannot trick you about that. So we can't be tricked that we are experiencing doubt. That's impossible. And so if you're doubting, right? You're thinking, right? So dubito ergo cogito. I doubt, therefore I think. And if I'm thinking, there must be, and this is the key point, there must be a subject that is doing the thinking. Must be a subject that is doing the thinking. Where can we fit that in? Let's pop it in here. We'll make this, I think we're gonna have huge text. Let's make this smaller. Experience. Hey, I did it right. Okay, so let's... There must be something that is experiencing the thinking. So maybe we don't have bodies. Maybe we cannot trust math. Oh, you can't see me, can you? You can't see this. Let's just move this over here. There must be a subject that is experiencing the thinking. And so that is I. That's you. That's me. We don't know anything else at this point. We only know the cogito. We only know that we must exist as a mind. Don't know if we have a body. Okay, so that is, when we zoom out, that becomes our foundation. We've torn everything down, right? All of this we've torn down. Our senses, history, physical bodies, and reason itself, right? We've torn all that down, and what we're left with, right, the foundation, is the cogito, that there must be a subject, and that subject is a mind, right? So let's circle this and let's say is a mind. It's got to be that subject that's thinking. Okay, so we're not left with much. All we can know at this point is that we exist as minds, and that's it. That's not a lot. So he wants to say, okay, now that I have this foundation, like a brick, right? What can I put on top of it that I know is true? So this is where Descartes, we can criticize Descartes, but let's look at what he does next. So this is his goal now, right? So he's found the firm foundation. Now he says, okay, I still don't know if I can reason because maybe God's a trickster. But let's think about this a little bit. So, we have in our minds, he says that we have this clear and distinct idea. He calls them impressions of clear and distinct ideas. We might call them intuitions. And in class, we talked a little bit about intuitions. We talked about moral intuitions, but Descartes thinks we have other ones. Anything that we have is a clear and distinct impression. Now that counts as something we can talk about. So he says, we have a clear and distinct impression that we're not perfect. And he says, we have a clear and distinct impression that perfect cannot come from the imperfect, right? So if I have a bowl of rotting apples, left by themselves, they will never become the best apples ever, right? You cannot move from gross to good. And also, we have this idea that greater cannot come from the lesser. This is important. This will be very important. So if I have one computer mouse, I cannot, without doing anything or without adding, have two computer mice. That's impossible. Greater cannot come from lesser. Two cannot come from one. So with this in mind, he also notices that he has an idea. And he has an idea that a being exists that is perfect. And so then the question is, all right, where does this idea come from? So we have this question that he wrestles with. Now let's think through our options. Can it come from outside? No. Because this is something he can think of without having to ever look at anything in the world. That just kind of closed off in his mind. We can imagine that there is a being that is perfect. That's an idea we can have. So next option. Now I have these already marked out, but next option. Well, maybe he made it up. I mean, that's possible, right? We can make up ideas of things. But this is the idea of a being that is perfect. Now, we said over here that perfect cannot come from imperfect. Remember, Descartes realizes that he is imperfect. So what does that mean? So it can't come from him, right? He can't have created, in his mind, in his argument, he can't have created the idea of a perfect being. Because he's imperfect. And as we claimed here, perfect cannot come from the imperfect. So what is the source of the idea? Where does the idea come from? Well, it must come from the perfect being itself. Now, what do we call this? What do we have a name for beings that are perfect? Well, we call that thing God. So, at this point, Descartes says that a perfect God must exist, and it must have given him, right, this idea of a perfect being of itself. Now, let's think about this. Is doing harm more perfect or less perfect than not doing harm or helping? Seems like helping or love is better than hate or tricking. Lying, telling the truth, is more perfect than lying, Descartes would say. And so if that's the case, and God is perfect, then God does not lie. And so this is his next brick in the wall that he's building. A perfect God would not trick us. What does this let back in the door? Over here, if you remember, I need to erase all of this, all of these scribbles. So let's do that a little bit. And let's just get rid of this, right? We have this issue of maybe an evil demon is tricking us. But we just figured out that a perfect God exists, right? Over here. Now, if a perfect God exists, then that God is not tricking us. And so because of that, we can trust good reasoning. Not just any reasoning, but we can trust good reasoning. But what we cannot do, we have not solved the problem of the senses. We've not solved the dreaming problem. And we know from experience that sometimes we do dream, sometimes our senses lie to us. So that's not a hypothetical. That's something that we experience. So what this means is we cannot know about the outside world. Now, I have just that, but we might add the for sure. So we'll put dot, 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 for sure, period. Because of this, because we can only reason, well, he is called a rationalist. And so when we talk about rationalist, not just being rational, but the rationalist approach to knowledge, this is what it is. We can't know for sure anything about the outside world. Our standard of knowledge is certainty. Do we have that anywhere? Here we go, over here. Never forget that his standard, right, his criteria for knowledge is absolute certainty. We can know rational things that are not dependent upon the outside world, so things like math. We can know that for sure. Whenever we move to talking about the outside world, right, because of all of this, we cannot be sure. We still it is still unreliable. And again, with this project, we only can count certainty, those things that are certain to be knowledge. So this is rather limited. But look what we've been able to do. And I'll erase some of the markings that can be a little confusing. But we have, let's get a big, thick, we'll do green. Okay, right? We've gone down. Well, that's not very thick at all. There we go. That should be better. Right? We've gone down this hole. We found our foundation. And then we've been able to move out. Now, we haven't gotten as far as we might want. But we have made progress. And Descartes, he says, you want to know what we can know? This is what we can know. And we have to live with the fact that we can't know for sure stuff about the outside world. All we can really know is good reasoning. We take inputs from these clear and distinct ideas or impressions, and we do good reasoning, and then we can build that kind of knowledge. But what we cannot do, and we don't want to delude ourselves, is the thinking that we know about the outside world. That just is not the case. It's just not possible. All right. So let's do a little bit of analysis of his thinking. Okay, here's the main critique. Our first critique is what we call the Cartesian circle. And let's look at this reasoning, right? A perfect God exists. A perfect God would not trick us. Therefore, we can trust good reasoning. But notice that we used reason to say that a perfect God exists. Right? All of this stuff up here. All of this stuff over here. Right? All of this. We reasoned through it. And if we reason through it before we know that we can trust our reasoning, well, that undercuts itself. This is a classic example of circular reasoning. And circular reasoning is where you use the conclusion of your argument as one of the premises for that same argument, right? So here we say it uses reason to prove that God exists. And he uses that God exists to prove reason. So again, we have this circular reasoning here. And that is, at least for a foundationalist, and he's a foundationalist, we'll talk about that later, that undercuts everything that is built upon it. So what that would mean isn't that his whole project is wrong or false, but it would mean, the implication would be, is that, and let's get this green back. Actually, let's use black, right? No. Let's use red. That red sounds fun. Or pink. I don't know. Doesn't matter. Right? So if this is the part where it falls apart, what that means is all of this is gone, and we are stuck here. So we can still employ Descartes' project. All of these things still seem like they work, right? If we're doing this radical doubt, but we cannot move beyond the cogito. So we know we exist as minds, but that's it. So maybe we can still do Descartes' project, but we are stuck down here at the cogito. Let's look at the cogito itself. Let's think about the mind. This brings us to our second critique. Our second critique states that maybe Descartes did not drill down deep enough. From other philosophic traditions, such as Hume's radical skepticism, or Buddhist understandings of the self, they notice that there isn't just a singular mind that stays the same. And that our mind doesn't exist without the brain doesn't exist without the rest of the body. And really, instead of there being a stable mind, we are a bundle of things. We perceive, we sense, we reflect, we are aware. All of those things are components of the mind, and maybe we can doubt parts of them, or maybe it's just a variety of things. So maybe we don't ever, with the cogito, drill down far enough, right? Maybe the thing that exists, this subject, is a bunch of different things, right? And then he did not investigate those things. So at the minimum, this critique says there's more work to do. Or maybe there's not a self there at all. Maybe that's just an illusion, just like all of these things are an illusion. And that's pretty troubling. But maybe that's what we have to deal with. We can also take this line of argumentation, and we can talk about, right, the ego, the id, and the super ego. Maybe the self has these three components that we can then talk about. And where do the we that's we, where's the you that is you, where does it reside? Does it reside in the bundle of these things? Does it reside here, there, or there? All of these things are stuff that we would have to analyze. So from this philosophic tradition, or this social science position, maybe there's more work to do. And man, that looks like a mess. Let's just get rid of it all. All right. And so then this is the last critique. Maybe he's using the wrong standard of knowledge. I mean, sure, if we want to be absolutely, absolutely, absolutely certain, maybe the rationalists and Descartes are the way to go. But it might be the case that, well, they're using a bad standard. If I go to judge a person's basketball ability by the number of touchdowns they scored last week, well, that seems to be the wrong measure. And so the question is certainty a good measure of knowledge? It certainly isn't very pragmatic, right? If all we know is, and let's get rid of this, right? If all we can know is good reasoning, that doesn't really leave us much. And so maybe, and this is what Locke does, maybe we need to have probability as our standard of knowledge. And if that's the case, well, let's look here, right? So let's erase some of this, right? So if we can talk about, well, is history likely to be true, unlikely to be true, right? We can talk about probability there. We can talk about probability here. You know, right now, honestly, it's probably the case that you're not dreaming. You could be, but I bet not. Same with me, right? So we're done. Now we can talk about other stuff, right? We don't have to go down this rabbit hole. We don't have to do all of this messy guesswork, ultimately. Instead, when we have the probability as a standard of knowledge, we can do other things. And that is going to open up empiricism. Okay. And that's what we're going to be looking at next week. John Locke, as our empiricist, he's our stand-in for the empiricist position. And just to give you a quick preview, we'll look at him. We'll look at implications of this notion that we don't know what substance is. Locke will admit that. And so that'll move us into subjective idealism with Berkeley. And then we'll look at really strict empiricism, radical empiricism with Hume. So that'd be kind of a preview. I think we've talked about all that we want to talk about. We've kind of talked through these things. Yeah, that's enough. All right, so that is the rest of the lecture we weren't able to get to. And so I will talk to you online and see you next week.